Although they may seem like a different breed, the truth is that royals are just as prone to drama as the rest of us. As such, there's no shortage of disastrous royal marriages to be found in the annals of history. Here are some of the very worst. Armed with a top-notch education and a humongous inheritance, Eleanor of Aquitaine was one of the most powerful women of the Middle Ages, and by quite some margin, too. She was first crowned Queen of France after marrying Louis VII and enjoyed considerable influence over the king. Things weren't exactly rosy between these two lovebirds, though. Simmering resentment, rumors of her infidelity, and the birth of two daughters rather than a male heir led the couple to annul their marriage in 1152. They cited consanguinity as the reason, that is, the fact that they were third cousins once removed. But consanguinity didn't stop Eleanor from marrying another, more closely related third cousin just 2 months later. Her second husband, Henry of Anjou, later became Henry II of England. Over nearly two decades, Eleanor played an active role in ruling Henry's empire, while birthing five sons and three daughters along the way. But they weren't exactly a happy family either. In 1173, two of Eleanor's sons involved her in a plot against Henry, and she willingly offered them no small amount of military support. Some historians even wonder if Eleanor instigated the revolt herself as vengeance against her husband's infidelities. Either way, Henry II soon found out about the plot and imprisoned Eleanor for 16 years. She was freed after Henry's death in 1189, but ultimately couldn't escape her husband. Upon her death in 1204, she was buried next to him in France's Fontevraud Abbey. Better known as the She-Wolf of France, Isabella of France's rise to power began in 1308 with her marriage to Edward II and their coronation as king and queen. By that point, however, Edward had been infatuated with a southern French nobleman named Pierce Gaveston for years. Even at the time, many speculated that Gaveston was the king's lover as well as his confidant. Their relationship didn't exactly end well, though. Gaveston was assassinated in June 1312 by a group of English barons who had grown tired of his considerable influence over the king. After that, a nobleman named Hugh Despenser the Younger became Edward's new favorite, and it's pretty hard to understate just how much Isabella despised him. When King Edward went to war with Isabella's brother, Charles IV, in 1324, he began to treat Isabella as his enemy rather than his wife. She quickly found a new lover in Roger Mortimer, and together they led a rebellion against the reign of Edward and Despenser. The rebel group invaded England on September 24, 1326, capturing and violently executing Despenser. The king's support crumbled immediately, and Edward was ordered to hand over the throne to his and Isabella's son, who was crowned Edward III of England at just 14 years old. A few years later, however, the 18-year-old Edward decided to take his rule into his own hands, executing Mortimer and putting Isabella under arrest for 2 years. She retired from politics and died in 1358. Henry VIII became involved with an impressive six wives and countless mistresses over the course of his 36-year rule. But his soap opera/horror show of a love life also led to devastating global consequences, including an unstable succession, a number of wars, and ultimately, England's break with the Catholic Church. When Henry married Catherine of Aragon in 1509, his top priority was to continue his bloodline by producing a male heir to the throne. But their only surviving child was a daughter. Frustrated, the king annulled their marriage, pretty much destroying England's relationship with the Vatican in the process, and moved on with Anne Boleyn. But she, too, bore a daughter. Henry subsequently accused Anne of adultery and treason and had their marriage annulled, too, before ordering her execution. A few days after Anne's beheading, Henry married her lady-in-waiting, Jane Seymour, who finally gave Henry his desired male heir, but abruptly died due to complications of childbirth. Sometime later, Henry saw a portrait of Anne of Cleves and decided to marry her, only to discover the painting bore no real-life resemblance to the woman herself. As one recent documentary so deftly pointed out,
"This was the Tudor equivalent of a first date with someone you've met online, only to find out that they don't exactly look like their photo."
Another divorce ensued. Henry famously referred to his next wife, Catherine Howard, as his rose without a thorn, until she was beheaded due to rumors of adultery. Henry's sixth and final marriage to Catherine Parr was his smoothest, and she even managed to outlive him by a whole year. The trope of the disapproving mother-in-law is almost as old as time. or at least as old as 1682, the year Sophia Dorothea married George Louis. George was Sophia's cousin and an elector of Hanover, and he later became King George I of England. Sophia's mother-in-law and aunt, an electress also named Sophia, addressed Sophia Dorothea with such disdain that it soon poisoned George's own perception of his wife. Feeling the weight of her husband's hatred, Sophia Dorothea joined forces with Count Philip Christoph von Königsmarck in a failed attempt to escape from Hanover. When George learned of this conspiracy in 1694, he had the count killed, divorced Sophia Dorothea, and imprisoned her in a stately home in Alden, Germany. Sometimes known as the Princess of Alden, Sophia remained in prison for 32 years until her death in 1726. She died without ever having set foot in England. In 1744, the aristocrat Sophie of Anhalt-Zerbst headed to Russia to meet her second cousin, the Russian heir Peter III. Although many people were fans of the vivacious Sophie, she and Peter quickly developed a mutual distaste for each other. Even so, the two teenagers held an arranged, elaborate wedding the following year, and Sophie changed her name to Ekaterina, the Russian equivalent of Catherine. Their union didn't exactly start on a blissful foot, though, as Peter decided he'd rather spend their wedding night partying with his friends than stay with her. But then again, his wedding night did look like this. Still, things only got worse from there. While Catherine distracted herself from her husband by reading books by Enlightenment authors, Peter had been a poor student and spent most of his time playing soldiers with his own guards' units. Before long, the ill-suited spouses were each engaging in extramarital affairs. After Peter's aunt, Empress Elizabeth, died in 1762, Peter became ruler of Russia and severed Catherine's social alliances. Convinced that Peter planned to divorce her, Catherine gathered her social resources to lead a coup against him, and the Russian church crowned her the nation's ruler. Meanwhile, Peter was arrested, deposed, and exiled. He died just over a week later, while Catherine the Great went on to rule for 34 years, the longest reign of any woman in Russian history. When Caroline of Brunswick and George IV first laid eyes on each other in 1795, she told him that he wasn't half as handsome as his portrait had been. He, on the other hand, staggered backwards and immediately asked for a brandy. Not a great start, all things considered. George, who was then the Prince of Wales, preferred more mature women, while Caroline was known for being inappropriate and was often mocked for her foul body odor. On their wedding night, George got thoroughly drunk and passed out in a grate, and Caroline left him there. The prince soon deserted Caroline for his 5+ mistresses. After the couple's inevitable separation, Caroline was given permission to see their daughter for just 2 hours a week. When she adopted another son and a daughter, she was accused of bearing another man's children, but was found not guilty in 1805. Caroline then moved to Italy once her royal duties were kaput. There, she found romance with a messenger named Bartolomeo Paragami. When George became king in 1820, he tried to pay Caroline to stay in mainland Europe, but she returned to assume her role as queen. In the end, George had her barred from his coronation at Westminster Abbey, and when she tried to get in, the deputy Lord Chamberlain slammed the door in her face. Caroline pounded on the door, but to no avail. She fell ill that night and died just 19 days later. Known to her friends as Ducky, Princess Victoria Melita had a lot to live up to as Queen Victoria's granddaughter. And although the princess fell in love with her Russian cousin, Cyril Vladimirovich Romanov, her royal grandmother had other plans. The queen deemed Cyril too foreign for Ducky and arranged for her to marry her other cousin, Grand Duke Ernest of Hesse. Although Ernest was gay, he reluctantly agreed to marry the princess. Drowning in the loneliness of a loveless marriage, Princess Victoria begged her grandmother to allow a divorce. Alas, such a thing wouldn't happen on Queen Victoria's watch. When the queen died in 1901, the princess demanded a divorce again, which prompted Ernest's sister, Empress Alex of Russia, to become her sworn enemy. Following her only daughter's death from typhoid, a grieving Princess Victoria quietly wed her first love, Cyril. In an act of vengeance, Alex took Cyril's title from him. Alex also demanded he hit the road, so Cyril and the princess gladly relocated to Paris, soon welcoming two daughters. Before long, though, Alex's husband, Tsar Nicholas, asked Cyril to come back to Russia, and almost overnight, Ducky became the Grand Duchess Victoria Fyodorovna. In 1973, Princess Anne's wedding to Captain Mark Phillips was televised from Westminster Abbey and watched by more than 500 million viewers around the world. Princess Anne had met the captain in 1968 at a party for horse lovers, and they got engaged 5 years later. Upon their engagement, a reporter asked Princess Anne whether she believed the marriage could withstand the pressure of public duty. She answered, "It's got to, hasn't it? But no marriage can survive on horses alone." Trouble brewed as the couple's respective work duties began to take precedence, and their public appearances together became fewer and fewer. Even when traveling together, the princess and the captain would check into separate hotels, and that was just the tip of the iceberg.
Should we leave by different doors?
Came in the same car.
In 1989, the press reported that Phillips had engaged in semi-public affairs with a British television anchorwoman, a Canadian public relations executive, and an Indian call girl. The couple separated that year when intimate letters were unearthed between Princess Anne and one Commander Timothy Lawrence. Then, in 1991, an art teacher from New Zealand told the Express that she had a child by Phillips 5 years prior, before his separation from the princess. Though the captain denied these claims, a DNA test promptly proved his paternity. Despite the princess' initial vow to stay legally married to the captain, their divorce was finalized in 1992.
Well, there were three of us in this marriage, so it was a bit crowded.
That's what Princess Diana had to say about her relationship with Prince Charles in her infamous 1995 Panorama interview. Her and Prince Charles' romantic turmoil began long before they were married, however. According to the biography Diana, Her True Story, Charles told Diana that she was, quote, a bit chubby, a week after their engagement. The comment was a catalyst for Diana's bulimia, which, as she revealed in the book, he also criticized for being a, quote, waste of food. As their marriage went on, Diana's mental health struggles escalated, and in her biography, she even said Charles brushed her off after she threw herself down a flight of stairs. Of course, Prince Charles' ongoing and at times overt love affair with Camilla Parker Bowles was at the heart of the royal couple's undoing. The affair, combined with Diana's feelings of inadequacy and displacement within the royal establishment, led the couple to part ways in 1992. Their divorce was finalized in 1996, the year after Diana's explosive Panorama interview. Worst of all, though, the couple's marital difficulties drew major attention from the tabloid media, which contributed to the circumstances of the princess' tragic death in 1997. Check out one of our newest videos right here! Plus, even more Nikki Swift videos about the royals are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.